Yeah, so in October of 1949, Mao Tse-tung marches into Beijing with his communist armies. And he goes straight to Tiananmen Square, to the Forbidden City, and he stands on the balcony, there where you see his picture. He stands on the balcony there. That's what the emperors had been doing for hundreds of years. When they would want to address the nation, they would stand on the balcony there to the entrance to the Forbidden City. Mao Tse-tung goes and stands in that balcony. And he proclaims that from now on, China will be a revolutionary Marxist society. In other words, he is proclaiming that he now, Mao Tse-tung, with his political philosophy, is replacing Confucius as the political authority within China. That the communist ideology, as described in a little red book that he wrote, this little red book, which every Chinese had to study thoroughly from university to elementary grade, this little red book will become the new statement of values for China. And the Confucian values, which call the country to look back to the way things were a couple thousand years ago as they followed the Lee, that system he is proclaiming is now finished. He is replacing that system. So in that, standing at Tiananmen Square on that balcony, he is declaring that, in effect, he is the new modern Confucius for the modern day. That was the Communist Revolution, which affected all of China very, very profoundly. In 1971, another event took place which very significantly continued the transformation of China. Henry Kissinger, who is the American Secretary of State, went on a secret journey to China and met the Chinese authorities in Beijing. Now remember, these Chinese authorities believe that China is the Middle Kingdom, and that the Marxist way is the way in which they will spread the Marxist revolution to the ends of the earth. That they had that kind of a mission. And Kissinger comes and he meets with these authorities in Beijing, and he invites China to become part of the community of nations, as a nation among nations. He says that the U.S. would be ready to work with China to become a member of the United Nations Security Council and to begin a journey of cooperation and working together with all the nations in the world. That was his invitation. And China accepted that invitation. And so in 1971, China began the process of becoming part now of the world community of nations. You know, the Confucian ethic, which said that China is the Middle Kingdom and the center of the cosmos. And when the Chinese emperor lives in harmony and in wisdom, the whole universe is blessed by his righteous living. That China is the Middle Kingdom, the center of the universe. That sort of Confucian philosophy, Kissinger was saying, I'm encouraging you to lay that aside and view yourselves as one nation among other nations, cooperating with other nations in the world. And China accepted that responsibility. And that has been bringing about a very profound transformation within China over the years, as the Chinese people and the Chinese nation, with these traditional Confucian values that they have basically moved in other directions now, with those values becoming a participant in the world community of nations. And it brings a lot of challenges, a lot of stresses, but a lot of opportunities as well. It's a new day, we would say, in China, as China begins that journey forward in these new directions. So the U.S. goes to China and we say, you should become more democratic. Now, this Confucian understanding of a political system is not about democracy, is it? Yes, the Chinese had their form of democracy, but it's a form of democracy which continues to function in many ways very similar to Confucianism, which says you need to have some wise people to select those people who are ready and prepared to lead, you see. And so it used to be the scholars, that's what Confucius put in place, the scholars, they would decide. And then when the Communist Revolution took place, it became the Communist Party that would decide. And so the Chinese Communist Party becomes this sort of new community of scholars that determines who is worthy to run for president and all that kind of thing. And so China is learning the way, as is the whole world, of how to work together, cooperate together, work at human rights issues and so forth, in light of this Confucian political philosophy, which truly the country has moved in the directions of embracing other philosophies of governance, and yet so many of the values and so forth of Confucianism continue to be very, very important in China.
We invite you to participate in the International Bible Teaching and Gospel Sharing Project. Whether these Christian expanded educational opportunities will become available to people around the world depends on all of us. We very much need and appreciate your prayer and financial support. For more information, please visit tvsseminary.com.
Let me conclude with a story. Singapore would be very influenced by Confucian values, though it's a democratic city-state. But Confucian values very much inform the Chinese people of Singapore. And so in one of my recent visits to Singapore, I was having dinner, and this host was saying how wonderful Singapore is, that we have a wise president who has been selected by the wise people of this city, and he leads this city forward in wise ways. And as we emulate his counsel and his wisdom, the whole city experiences prosperity as we move forward. And these values are very much based upon Confucian values, which we find to be enduring. Values such as shu and gen, altruism. Values such as seeking to be genuinely righteous people. Values that practice filial piety, respect for parents and so forth. Those values are very, very important. And so we had this lovely lunch together. And then the taxi cab driver picked us up, and he was taking us to the airport, I guess it was. And he said, you know, Singapore, a very nice city. No problems in Singapore. President tells us what we should do, and we do what president says, and so everything is peace in Singapore. Like, for example, Singapore, very clean. No chewing gum. No chewing gum on sidewalks. If you put chewing gum on sidewalk, $100 fine. $100 fine for chewing gum on sidewalk. Very clean city. President says, no chewing gum on sidewalk, and so no chewing gum on sidewalk. We follow advice of president very carefully. He was echoing, I think, a very Confucian value, that the political leadership are wise, we should listen to what they have to say, and accept their cultivation of the kinds of values that help our city to prosper and to be a healthy, good place in which to live and to work. Very interesting. So keep your eyes tuned to China. It's a great nation, it's on the way, and it is continually experimenting with what sorts of Confucian values are helpful in this modern day and what kinds of values they need to transform as they move forward.